This is a quick introduction to recurrence relations. If you already feel comfortable with where they come from, you might want to skip to more advanced videos, or at least jump to the part where I justify rounding off values, but I won't get to that until I get through a few examples first. So I'll start with a famous Fibonacci sequence. The zeroth number in the sequence is zero, the first is one, and after that, each number in the sequence is the sum of the previous two numbers. And here's a terrible recursive program to calculate the nth number. Assuming that the numbers stay small enough to add in constant time, and ignoring the runtime of the recursive calls, it takes constant time to calculate. But you have those recursive calls, and they're made with arguments n minus 1 and n minus 2. If we use t as a function for this program's runtime, we can write t of n like this in terms of t with smaller arguments. This is known as a recurrence relation. It's going to pop up in our runtime analysis for recursive programs. To be complete, we also give a base case, but generally the base case is just going to be that the program takes some constant amount of time to run for some fixed-sized inputs. For this program, the runtime actually grows like the Fibonacci sequence itself because the recurrence relation looks so similar to the Fibonacci definition. Now, it doesn't have to be that way. Fred Fibonacci's dim-witted next-door neighbor, Barney Bolinachos, tried to come up with his own similarly defined sequence. If we write down a program for that sequence using its recursive definition and think about its runtime, it still has two recursive calls to problems with the same sized arguments as the Fibonacci program. So its runtime would be about the same as the Fibonacci's program's runtime. However, the sequence isn't so interesting because it's zero everywhere except at n equals 1, so history has forgotten Barney. Moving to a slightly more useful program, imagine that we have unsorted linked list of values. And we want to search those values for one in particular, and we just return true or false if it's in the list. If the list has n items, we could search the first one and then recursively search the rest of the list. The check at the current location takes constant time. And then if we don't find the value, we have recursive call to the next item in the list, which has one fewer items in its remaining list. This gives us another recurrence relation. Notice the less than or equal sign here. For this program, if you find the value, you just stop there and there wouldn't be any more recursive calls. Here, we can only say this program has a constant time for its lower bound. Moving on to probably the most widespread computer science recurrence relation example, we look at merge sort. For that program, we recursively sort the first half of the array and then the second half, and then merge the two sorted halves together to sort the entire array. The merge and all the non-recursive calls take linear total time, and the two recursive calls are each to about half of the array, so we get a recurrence like this one. We see that the floors and ceilings are a bit ugly, and it'd be much nicer to not worry about them. I generally just pretend that all divisions happen nicely, and I'll kind of justify that laziness here. For this recurrence, if n is a perfect power of 2, the two versions are the same. The next videos in the series will go into how to solve recurrence relations, but this one happens to have an n cubed solution. Well, if n isn't a power of 2, imagine solving it for the two surrounding perfect powers of 2. It turns out each of these functions, both the one that's too big and the one that's too small, they both grow like n cubed. And if t of n is between two functions, each of which grows like theta of n cubed, then t of n is theta of n cubed. More generally, for increasing function, any recurrence should be bounded between the cases of rounding everything down versus rounding everything up. If those two cases give the same order of growth, seems like we're safe to use one of them. Using the substitution method, which is the next video, assume that all divisions happen nicely and solve. If you get an answer that doesn't grow too quickly, then rounding up versus down shouldn't have mattered. They'll each use an inductive step with the same order of growth. That happens over a huge group of functions, at least constant through regular exponential. It doesn't happen to be true for some really fast-growing functions like n factorial, but once you're talking about runtimes like that, I suspect that rounding won't be your biggest problem. I won't try to formally define and prove exactly when it's safe to do this here, but for basic stuff, you shouldn't get into trouble. Okay, the next video will deal with the substitution method for solving these equations. There will also be videos on the recursion tree method and the master method, but for now, I need to finish my ballad to those two famous neighbors, Fred and Barney. Yabba dabba doo.